Hey folks, Mika here from the land not on most world maps. April had plenty of titles to keep us occupied with only a handful of AAA titles. May is almost here though, and while the number of releases are few, it's hard to deny that there are some heavyweights which change the gaming landscape in there. First up is Redfall by Arkane Studios. You know them for Dishonored and Prey, but unlike these older games, Redfall can be played in multiplayer. The premise is that you're taking control of a bunch of survivors in a town where vampires have taken over. And as you can expect from the storyline, each of the four heroes you can choose from come with their own set of wacky powers. You have, for example, an engineer with a robot dog who can both blow stuff sky high or heal allies. You have a sniper who can go invisible and call in what I think is a raven for support. You then have a telekinetic lady who can put up shields and structures to gain an advantage in combat. And then finally, what seems like a gadgeteer who uses, well, gadgets to stun enemies and even teleport. Admittedly, as someone who has not got his hands on it, it all looks like a good, fun, jolly co-op experience to me. But most likely you all already know that the reception to Redfall has been less than stellar. We had that botched preview by IGN, and then the news that the game is locked to 30 FPS for Xbox on release. Not to mention the many previews by other YouTubers who just feel like the game might be missing that one thing which makes it click. Either way, be curious to see how Redfall fares on release early on May. Continuing the horror trend, our next selection is Amnesia: The Bunker by Frictional Games. I feel like it goes without saying, the first Amnesia game, Dark Descent, was one of those hallmark horror games that comes around once in a blue moon and changes the landscape around it. But Frictional Games, like Arkane Studios from our first pick, is working to build on the idea of their previous title. The setting is, as expected, different. This time, it's during World War I, where the protagonist is trapped in a bunker along with a creature that's out to kill him. But this is where the bunker sort of differs from its predecessors and other horror games significantly. For starters, the game is a semi-open world, giving the player the freedom to completely explore from the outset and decide where and how you want to proceed. Along with this, the game randomizes key items and resource spawns, making it so that you can't apparently memorize your way through. As you go through the bunker, you then have to draw the line between when to use your tools. Your grenades and gun might help you to proceed, but it might draw your stalker to your location. Same with your light source, which creates a very loud noise. But you need the light because the creature itself hunts in the dark. With that in mind, I for one am interested in seeing how Amnesia: The Bunker shakes up the horror formula. Speaking of games which change the landscape around them, we have the reboot of System Shock by Nighttime Studios. If you haven't played it, the original System Shock is widely credited with the creation of the first-person sim, including the survival and RPG elements which we see from many games these days. Set in a cyberpunk future, in System Shock you take the role of this hacker, who has been caught breaking into the systems of a futuristic corporation. In return for their freedom, the hacker makes a deal with the CEO of that company to make modifications to an AI called Shodan on the corporation's space station. Naturally, these modifications lead to a lot of trouble, as Shodan takes control of the space station, turns everyone into cyborgs and mutants, and begins a rampage towards Earth. And as a person responsible for the mess, you gotta clean it up. Apart from the updated HD visuals, the remake also comes with an overhaul to the game's design. Map layouts have been cleaned up to make it less confusing. Enemies have dismemberment mechanics, and you can even customize the difficulty to suit your needs. Either way, we are quite excited for a new player base to meet perhaps one of the most recognizable villains in gaming history, with System Shock. I think, like many of you, when the Lord of the Rings Golem was announced, we kinda raised an eyebrow, both in confusion and interest. Golem isn't exactly what you would call protagonist material. Daedalic Entertainment thought otherwise though, so here we are. The game is supposedly going to tell us the untold story of Golem, of how he escaped from Mordor and made it to the dungeons of the Elven King Thranduil. As expected from our scrawny hobbits, gameplay seems to largely revolve around stealth and navigation, where you have to hide in tall grass, create distractions, climb and jump to proceed. All throughout the journey, you'll be wrestling with the two sides of our protagonist, Smeagol and Golem, sort of creating this moral choice system, but it feels like it might not exactly be clear-cut, since sometimes you'll have to rely on his more selfish and sinister side to actually get through areas safely, and your choice between the two personalities ultimately dictates how the story ends. With the successful transition of book to game by Hogwarts Legacy, I'd honestly like it if the Lord of the Rings franchise makes an equally good entry on current-gen hardware with Lord of the Rings Golem. You knew it, and I knew it. This was definitely gonna be on our list. The Legend of Zelda, Tears of the Kingdom, continues on from Breath of the Wild with Link and Zelda trying to rebuild the realm of Hyrule. But the task is cut short when Ganondorf, the king who was responsible for the previous calamity, is revived, bringing about a complete change in the landscape. In the ensuing chaos, Link is once again separated from Zelda, the Master Sword is damaged, and it's up to our silent hero to once again find the princess, investigate the cause, and help put things right. Well, initially the announcement of a sequel received a skeptical scathing, citing it as a Breath of the Wild DLC. Recent previews have shown that Tears of the Kingdom is not resting on its laurels. Link's existing abilities have been expanded. Ascend allows you to rise up into the air and pop out through ceilings and structures, helpful for navigating the new set of islands floating around. Fuse allows Link to, well, link weapons and items together for various effects, like melding a key's eyeball to an arrow for homing effects, or stacking a boulder on a branch for a makeshift hammer. And the new Ultra Hand ability takes a page from the more creative aspects of Breath of the Wild to now allow you to engineer all those makeshift vehicles and automatons you dreamed of before. I can't wait to see what the gaming community is going to cook up with these skills. Link is not alone this time either, as all friends and new will join him to finally put an end to his age-spanning quest. Breath of the Wild was a literal game-changer, and though I can't quite say it will be the same this time, I feel like Tears of the Kingdom is already setting itself up for success. But what about you all? Do you think Tears of the Kingdom is gonna revolutionize games once again? Maybe you'd rather try out System Shock and Golem instead. Or maybe you'd rather pick another game to play in May. If so, let us know what it is in the comments below. Here's Mika from the land, not on most world maps, signing off.